So thanks to the new and for having me here again. So I was here last year. And thank you everyone, each one of you, for being here. So before I begin my session, so I have three questions for you. And if you agree with the, not really questions, statements, if you agree with the statements, just raise your hand. So the first one is, change is constant, right? Change is inevitable, so we can't escape from it, right? Change is beautiful. Really? So I would like to add a bit to the last statement, because when you say change is beautiful, yes it is, but that really depends on how much you have to change to adapt to that change. Let's talk about simple example of change of winters, and now we have spring, so everyone's loving it, right? Because it's something that we foresee, it's something that's simple to adapt to, it's something that we really like. We don't want to wear those woolen clothes now. But what about if you have to migrate your project, let's say Java project, from version 6 to version 11? Is that change beautiful?
Yes.
Yes? Yes. So the journey would have a lot of ups and downs. Not really everything would not be beautiful, right? So my point here is, change is constant, inevitable, but how beautiful it is, it really depends on how we adapt to the change, how much it's a torture for us. So here am I, so that's the purpose why I am here. So I would be talking about Project Amber, which is multiple JEPs, which is Java Enhancement Proposals, on which Oracle is working. And all those changes are for changes in the Java programming language. So some of them have already been released with Java 10, 11, and 12. I'll start with 10, not earlier than that. And some are still in pipeline. So if we know, as Java developers, if we know what are the changes that are going to come, it would be easier for us to adapt to the change. So quickly, I think, so that was already covered in the introduction. So the one thing which Dalaj missed was that I work as, so that was quite recent, I work as a developer advocate with JetBrains. If you have been using IntelliJ IDEA, so how many of you? Yes, so you would know, great. So I work as a developer advocate with JetBrains, also author of multiple books, founder. I also lead two communities in Delhi, so if you are not already participating in any of, not only these, but any communities of your choice, please do. That could be a game changer in your career. I'm also one of the Java champions. So we only have three from India, so I'm one of them. So as I said, I would be covering Project Amber. So the goal of Project Amber is to explore and incubate changes to the language, changes to the Java language. So every feature that we talk about, the ones which are in pipeline, they are being explored, and they are some of the ones who have already been released to the developers. Oracle doesn't guarantee that they would be included in the Java language. Some could be preview features, so they might stay on, they might be dropped in a future version of Java. So these are the ones that we would cover today. Type inference, and so as I said, I will start with Java 10. So three of them have already been released with Java 10, 11, and 12, and the others are in pipeline. Oracle has not attached any release date with these features. As and when they would be completed, they would be released with the next one. So I hope everyone's here is aware about the new release cadence that we have with Java now. So it's 6 months now, right? So everyone's, okay, good. So I'll start with the first one, which is type inference with var. So Java had type inference ever since its version 5, right? But now we are talking it explicitly with the restricted type var. Before I move on, any guesses what is the missing number here? Yes, that's right. I hope you did not know about this earlier. Right. So it's simple if I just have this image. Right. So what was, how did you manage, apart from if you had known it earlier, so how did you calculate? Sorry? Okay. So perhaps someone who did not know about it earlier but just figured it out right now. Any answers?
The way that 6 was written was a little odd.
Right. Right. Sorry?
The way you look at things.
Right. So the point here is that you already have the hints. And by the context, you could kind of infer the number which was missing. So that's what type inference is in Java, because we are still talking about statically typed language. We are not going towards dynamically typed language. So we still have the type safety. So let's work with an example. So this is how you would define your variables. And type inference is limited to local variables. We can't use it for static and instance variables. So this is typically how you would define your variables. So how many of you are already on Java 10 or a later version? Okay, good. Wow, good. So I have a good audience then. Okay, so have you already used var in your projects? Okay, then I have yet better audience. How about you?
In some places, yes. In legacy code, we are not. The new code.
Yes, of course. Doesn't make sense to go back and change all the legacy code that's already working and then introduce a lot of errors. So good. So this is how we typically define our local variables. And this is how we can do with var now. So if you compare these, I've dropped the data type here so that I can just use var. But as I said, we are still Java is still a statically typed language, so the compiler would infer the type of the variable by the information that you provide. So the information about all the type that you need is already there in the code. As you can see, the first line of code, so this is clearly a string. From the return type of local date time, compiler can figure out the type of date time. And of course, since we already have the information here, map could be assigned a type. And when I say a statically typed language, when you compile your code, compiler would insert the specific type in your code. The bytecode would have that type. So if you have already used a decompiler, how many of you have sometime used decompilers? Okay, good. So as you know, you can go back and see what was inserted in the code. So if you try to decompile the code that uses var, you can see that the compiler would have already inserted the specific type for you. And since we talk about knowing, having complete information to infer the type, if you try to assign a null value to it, then your code will not compile. So if you consider this as a variable and you assign a value null to it using var, then the compiler will not allow it to compile. It will not compile. So this is a quick example where we have, so this one is an uninitialized variable and the second one has been initialized with null. So again, both of these will not compile. So we talk about where you can define your variables using var and where you can't. So, is this legible from the back? No, not really. Kind of, okay. So, so we kind of asked Google Maps to just pinpoint the locations where we could define the variables using var. So we have the actual code on the next slide, don't worry. So this is an instance initializer block. How many of you have used it? I guess most of you. Yes, all of us. So you can define, so this would be, as we know, the code that you write in an instance initializer block goes to your constructor, and then you the code becomes local to the constructor. So as we said, it's var is applicable to local variables. So this is valid. We could also use it for static initializers block. We could use it for, of course, constructors, loops, switch statements. So we have another block of code here. And these are the places, again, we could use with try with resources statement. So again, that would be a local variable. So a quick check here. Do you think the first var will work? So how many for yes? Okay. The rest no or not decided? So how many for no? Okay, and the rest not decided? Okay, so the answer is no. It will not work. You cannot define your variables in a catch handler with var. Okay, now the second check. Can you define your method parameters using var? How many for yes? Okay, how many for no? Okay, so the answer again is no. You cannot define your method parameters using var. So we have restrictions at a lot of place where we could define it and where we couldn't. Of course, a lot of developers argue that since we all use IDEs, so IDEs are quick to tell us where we're going wrong. But a lot of times you might not be able to use an IDE, and that's when you need to know a lot of rules. And the other places that you need to know the rules is perhaps where you would unknowingly insert logical errors in your code. So we'll get to that point. Sorry?
What is the trigger behind this? So previously when we have the type where we are typing and everything, mm-hmm. at least the code is readable. So
right.
It's not always that I initialize my variable at the same place where I'm declaring it. I might be initializing it at some other place within the code.
Right.
So it is my personal opinion, the readability at least got better.
So you mean to say the readability of code goes down?
Went down with this syntax. Anyway, we are not going to the completely dynamic language to read the dynamic language.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We are inferring the type at the compile time. So
right.
What is the benefit to the developers? Yes, syntax is good, but what is the benefit?
So as developer, I would cover all those points in the later slides. I started with something saying that change is beautiful and it is not. So that's exactly what your concern is, that you think that what you code in is already perfect and you don't have to change. But perhaps when change is forced to you, you feel a bit uncomfortable, of course, because you have been coding in a certain way and it gets difficult to adapt to a new syntax. But we do have benefits, and you, if you perhaps like it, you can use it.
Yeah, in that way, Java is good. It's always backward compatible.
Right.
It's not forced always.
Right. Backward compatibility, yes. Okay, so first line, is this okay? Line number one, which assigns a value to a variable, counter. How
yes.
many for yes? Okay, and how many for no? Okay, reasons for yes and no. No, it is not string for sure. So that's the underscores that came in with Java 7. So with numbers, we could use underscores just to make the bigger numbers much readable. The way we use periods and commas. So that's how. So that with underscore, I could do that.
Double or something else?
What do you mean when you say the data type is not defined?
I mean, where at the time of compilation data, compiler will not know what kind of value it is. I mean, should I assign to it to a long or maybe to a double?
Mm-mm.
Or, but in the second row, it's defined as long.
Right. So do you have default types of literal values? In Java?
Integer.
Right.
Yes.
So the default values of literals is defined in Java.
Yes.
So if I do not prefix or suffix it with L, then this value would be considered as an int value.
Yeah, absolutely.
But now the compiler would try to assign an int value to a variable, a literal int to a variable which cannot hold that value. So then it would be a compilation error. But with the second one, since I have the prefix L, so now this literal value is kind of forced into being a long value, and then the inferred type of counter 2 will be long. So the first line of code will not compile, the second will. What about the third one? Will this compile? Can I use explicit casting with var? Yes? How many hands for yes? Okay, and how many hands for no? Okay, great. So how many are undecided? Okay. Okay, so you can use explicit casting. Because if you just look at this code, the one which is on the right of the equal sign, what we are doing here is, so that's a valid expression, right? So when you talk about a valid expression, so the compiler would infer the type there, it gets to char, and then this would be explicitly assigned a type char. So that's okay, so that works. So this is what I mentioned earlier. So we already have a couple of rules which are already there ever since Java was there with version 1.0. But it's the assumptions that we as developers have that this would work, or this is perhaps the data type and not this one, which would make it difficult for using newer features like var. So the compiler already knows the rules. It's the developers who need to be upgraded to know all the rules to use it optimally. Okay, so that's again a quick exercise. I won't let anyone sleep in the room. Okay, so what is the inferred type for total 1?
Long.
Right, and okay, that's right. Total 2?
Double.
Okay, and total 3?
Float.
So that's an exercise for you to find out which one, float or long. So which one would it be promoted to?
Long.
I'll not tell you the answer right now. So this is something that you have to find out. Because as we know, if we have some expressions where the data type is not same, the result is, yes, you're right. I'm missing the word there. Okay, now another one for you. So what would be the value? I'm not talking about the data type now. I'm talking about the value that would be assigned to a variable result.
2.5,
you said 2.5. Okay, so the answer is 2 and not 2.5, because we are talking about the division of two integers. And we, when we have expression which involves only integers, the decimal part is discarded. So 2 would be assigned to result. So let's talk about method chaining now. So a lot of time we do things like this. And without var, I would really have to know what char add returns to define this variable with the explicit type. But what happens if I could let the compiler bother with it and not myself? So this is how, this is where I think one of your answers would be. So why using var? So now I could just chill, and of course with IDEs, as I said, it's different, but we still need to know the rules. And this is one of the simplest example that I chose, because a lot of times the audience is not well versed with the other topics. But if you, I've seen most of us are Java developers here, what if you combine it with stream methods and the other methods, and what if I had to refactor it, make it simpler, I have to have checkpoints at places, and perhaps have just one of this in one variable, and then I call the remaining two on that variable. Then again, I'll have to go back to the API to find out the return type of the methods. But now, with var, I could just use var and let the compiler do the work. So type inferences with derived classes. What if we have two classes, let's say parent and child? So there are two simple classes. I have one method which is overridden by class child. And now let's come to this line of code where I have var obj is equal to new child. So in this case, since I'm defining, I'm initializing this variable using an instance of class child, I could easily do that because the type of infer type of object would be child. Now let me tweak this code a little bit. So the class parent and child remain the same, and I define a new method. So this is the method, which is get object, and now I return a type of parent from this method. Now do you think this will work, both the method calls? Why?
Because we are explicit that get object returns the object of type parent.
But when I run my code, I could have, wouldn't that work on the actual type?
No, because it is still a statically typed language, not a dynamic language.
Right, right. So when we are working with the newer features like var, we need to be very careful about the basic rules that we started with about what object could be assigned to a variable of implementing classes or implemented interfaces or extended classes, because this is the one of the basic rules that we worked with when we started with Java. But what happens as we tend to work with more code, we tend to forget some little things, so we really need to take care of things if we are using new features. So another example with var. So for the previous examples, we just saw that by just dropping the explicit data type, I could use var and just go on. But that really not happens always. So this is an example where the programmer just tries to chop off the data type, and then the compiler won't allow that. So this is the image, and this is the exact code. So what happens? All these three lines of code will not compile, because so you have to look at it in a way that what remains on the right side of the equal sign should make sense to the compiler, so that you have all the information that you need to infer the type. And if you can't do that, if you try to be a compiler and if you can't do that, the same applies to the compiler as well. Now this is how you could have the information about string being a char, and then you could do that. Okay, so we all know that with generics, I can't read that. Okay, sorry. So when we talk about generics, we all know that with generics we had type safety with our collections. So if the intention was to assign or to store certain type of objects, of course it allowed us to do so. But if we try it with var in a way that it's not supposed to, then we could lose type safety with generics. So here's an example. So this is typically how you define your variables that uses generics. But what if I change it to this? I have var names and then array list. So since I don't define a type here, I could add any type of object to this list, and this is not the intention. So now we are using a raw type. So if you define a variable which doesn't uses the type here, so that's called the raw type. I'm sure everyone would be good with that. Okay. So the solution is to again include all the information that we want on the right side of the equal sign. Okay, a quick check here. So will this code sort the list on the name or the price?
Depends how that
class. So you can assume that pen is a class which has name and price, and we could use the default sorting. So on the count of five, I would assume that we don't have the answer. One, two, three, four, and 5. Okay, the code will not compile. It's an immutable array, a collection. Have we done list of? Right? So this is not really connected with var, but it was try to reinforce that a lot of time we are looking at problems at places where they not are, right? Okay, so reassigning value is not possible with the var. If it so in the first case, age is of type integer, but in the next line of code, if we try to assign a double value to it, it will not work because the compiler has already inserted its explicit type, so we can't change the type while working with it. So in the second case, again, a string builder cannot be converted to a string. So as I said, explicits, I'll just quickly skip through it. So as I said, you could use explicit casting with the var because what is on the right side of the equals should make sense. Okay, is this possible?
Explicit casting.
But can you cast null to a type?
Yes.
So we have experts Java developers here, right? In
yes.
the room?
We can cast to error.
Sorry?
We can cast to error. When we call two methods in a class, which are null passing in the main function, and we have the string and object, the string one is called.
No, but we cannot explicitly cast.
Okay, so perhaps that's an exercise for you to try. I will not answer the question. Okay, so I would quickly skip through it. Okay, so yes, we can use it to, it could be misused to write bad code, as you said. So why would you switch to using var? So yes, it can be misused, but there are a lot of benefits as well. As I said, method chaining is one of them. I don't have to be bothered about what type is. And it is concise, convenient, because I could just use var and not be bothered about what type I would need, the explicit type. Of course, I am taking off a lot of verbosity, which a lot of programmers complain. It's more readable because once you define a variable and the next time you're reading your code, you don't really go back and check its type. You kind of use the variable name to determine what it's doing. So that way, I would say it improves readability. And of course, we are not using the, losing the type safety. So var was with Java 10. So we have local variable syntax for lambda parameters with Java 11. So we already had type inference when we talk about the parameters to lambda expressions. So how many of you have already programmed in Java 8 and lambda expressions? So most of us, right? Good. So we already had inference there, but this was just to keep up with the usage of var with the parameters here. So this is an implicitly typed parameter for the lambda expressions. This one is an explicitly typed, and now I could also use var with it. But of course, I cannot mix them. Okay, so mixing slide is gone. But the benefit is that I could also use annotations now. I did not know about the exact types to use the annotations. I could use var and then the annotations. We'll quickly go to switch expressions, which has been released with Java 12, and it's a preview language feature. So as I mentioned earlier, so we have a lot of enhancements, proposals, which are under Project Amber, and those changes could stay with Java. They could be dropped because Java, as you know, works with so many projects, and if there are multiple or serious issues with any new language feature, then it's good to drop the language feature. So as of now, we all have been using switch statements as a block of code. We could think of it as a multiple if-else statement. And this is not something we could use to assign or return a value. But with switch expressions, we could do that. Now, let's say we have an enum like this, and this is how you have been writing code to assign value to a variable based on the enum value. But now, you could, okay, so I deleted the slide perhaps. Okay, so now you could use switch expressions to return value. So in this example, you can see height is equal to switch, and you are switching on size and returning a value. So for case, so we can assume that size is an enum of which has constants like s and m, and now you have a change in syntax as well. What comes right to the arrow sign is the value would be returned. And apart from having just a single line of code, you could have a block, and in this case you would use a break statement to return the value. And you could of course completely skip this part and have case m, s. You could also have multiple case labels in one single branch. The other main benefit is that now we don't need to use break statements, because earlier what happened if we missed the break statements? You have a so that was legible now, thank you. So we can use multiple cases in the same switch branch, which was not allowed earlier. So we just had to copy paste the code, and as we all know, copy pasting code is one of the best places to have errors, right? The what we intend to, we don't modify, and that's how it works. And if we miss a break statement, then what happens is the control falls through, again leading to a logical error. So that's not required now. And when we use a switch expression to assign a value to the to any variable, the cases that we define must be exhaustive. What that means is, if I'm talking about an enum, I have a finite number of constants for an enum. So I could have cases like S, M, L, or whatever. And then, so for each value that I pass to pass here, I get a return value. What happens for cases like when I pass int or string? In that case, I don't have exhaustive list of values. So then the bet would be, the best bet or the only bet is to use a default label. So if the value is x, y, z, you return this value, else return this value. So switch expression must return a value if you are using it to assign a value. But of course, you could also use it as the older one, in which you are just using it to execute a set of statements. But of course, you could use this concise form, because all the ones who have been working with lambda expressions, they would really love this concise form. So exhaustive cases, I guess I moved the slide to the different order. So this is what I was talking about, multiple case labels in the same switch branch. And of course, as you can see, we don't have any break statements here, and the code is much simpler and concise to read. So I've already talked about both of these, default fall through of control without a break statement. So that's possible with the new switch expressions. And it's a preview language feature. It could be dropped if we have serious issues with this feature. So these are the ones which have already been released in the Java versions 10, 11, and 12. We'll quickly go through the ones which haven't been released and are in pipeline. So data classes is one of them. I guess most of us has already used data classes in some other languages. Yes. So what we love about that feature is the conciseness. Of course, I can use my IDE to define a class, say EMP, and in which I have only two variables, to generate all the getters, setters, and the other methods from class object. But the problem comes when we have to read that code, because then we're not sure whether the same code is what was generated by IDE or did we modify it. But if we use something like a data class where we have a single line of code, which we know by reading it that yes, we don't need to modify or add something. So I'll quickly browse through it. So this is an example image to show that yes, a lot of times we are told that you could use the same thing for everything. So till now we have been using class to define our data classes. Every kind of specialized classes that we need, we kind of have a lot of rules and bending here and there. And then after sometimes Oracle says, wow, you need this class, now we have something for you. So something like that, the way we had enums in Java 5. We had been defining the same pattern using our classes. But of course, if we have something in the language itself, it makes a lot of sense, and of course, less work for us developers. So this is what I said. You could have a class like EMP where you have only two variables, but you have to generate a lot of other code just to make it work, because we're talking about encapsulation and private variables. But what if we could define a data class just by this simple line of code. Now we talk about concise code, where we are not worried about reading a lot of code. As we all know, we write code once, but it's read much more, many more times.
Does this also have getter setter methods
built? Yes, so that's the answer to your question. So he just asked, so would that have getter setter for the variables? So behind the scenes, so this is also a syntactic sugar. Behind the scenes, the compiler would generate code like this, the way we do it with IDEs now. But as of now, the language, this doesn't allow us to do so. It's still in works. So Oracle has not confirmed whether you could modify some of the default behavior. Perhaps if you could add something to this between these curly braces, that would be copied to the compile code. What we have here, as good as overriding some of the functionality, I would say. Yeah. So now we quickly come to pattern matching. So all of us have had this problem of using instance of operator and then using the explicit casting. If we are using an editor, do we have to count the number of opening round braces? Yes. And if the placement is not right, okay, the IDE doesn't help. If the placement is not right, instead of getting a string, perhaps we get an integer or a stream, blah, blah, blah. Now, what if we could modify this and have something like this? By just introducing a variable here, I say if object matches ocean O, so if this match is okay, I could bind that object to the variable O. And then I could simply call a method or a member on that variable instead of having going through the pain of that round brackets. So this is testing the type. So it would it's being planned to incorporate it with the enums also, where you could test the type of the object that you're passing to a switch statement. So instead of just comparing the value, I could also say if type is string or integer and something like that. So that's it's still in works. So that's a quick comparison. Okay, so now we talk about enhanced enums. So how many of you have already tried adding members to your enums? So, okay, one, two, yes, some of us. So like a regular class, I could expand my enum and I could add members, variables, and methods to an enum. So this is how we normally define our enums, and this is how we could add more methods to it. So in this case, I could also define members which are specific to one enum constant. I could define, so the ones which are here, the constructor, get length, int length, and width, these all would be applicable and accessible by all the enum constants. But the one in red, these are specific to the enum constant medium. But again, with the current Java version that we have, we would not be able to access these values. Because what we are doing here is we are overriding some of the values, defining new ones. But in that process, I'm also creating a new class, which I'm subclassing to do that. We've already done that. If you try to extend a class anonymously, new something, and then define our code, so we create a new anonymous class. So that's what is happening here. And with enhanced enums, we all would be able to use generics with enums. So until now, okay, so this one will not compile, as I mentioned, because compiler cannot see the ones which are specific to one enum constant. So I'll quickly skip through this. And perhaps later you would be able to define something like this, enum data, and you have generics with enum. And that you could use at multiple places, things like this. So that would, of course, again, ease the development. And we as developers would have to write less code, and the language would be supporting us much more. So that's the last one, raw string literals. So how easy or difficult it is to store this value in a string? How many for easy? None. Okay. How many for difficult? All of us. We know we have to use a lot of special characters to negate the meanings of the letters that we have. What if we, and okay, so this is one of the ways we could do if we also have to include the formatting in the previous example. Of course, like this. Now let's add some more complexity. What if we had to define this as a string value, including the formatting? Again, a lot of problem, right? What if I told you I could use just an opening and closing backtick, and whatever comes within that opening and closing backtick would be considered as part of the string, including the formatting? So that's how we have string, raw string literals. It was planned to be included with Java 12, but it was dropped. So probably, I'm not sure, with Java 13, we still have some time. So yes, probably we can hope to have this with Java 13 now. So this, all the features that I covered are included in the next book of mine, which would be published next week. So if you are interested in having more details, then perhaps you could buy this one. So thank you very much. You have been a supportive audience. Thank you so much. I really hope that even if you can remember just three things from the session, I think I would consider my session to be good. Thank you very much.